Hello, Metal Matt here. I'm here with an absolute guitar legend today. It's the Shredding Master. It's my personal all-time favourite guitarist. I'm interviewing him here at his steel mill venue. Really cool place, lots of up-and-coming metal bands and some you might have heard of. Skid Row played here recently. It's just a really epic venue, so check it out. He's here to talk about his new book, Heavy Duty, Days and Nights in Judas Priest.
Absolute legend, K.K. Downing.
Matt.
Nice to meet you, K.K.
You too, Matt. Thank you for coming up to Wolverhampton and welcome to the steel mill.
Excellent.
Right, so we're here to talk about your new book, Heavy Duty, Days and Nights in Judas Priest. I was wondering, because the fans, I've heard quite a mixed thing of what the fans are expecting. They don't know if it's going to kind of be a kiss and tell or if it's about your life. What kind of thing will the fans expect from this book?
Well, I think the thing is that I decided after quite some time to do the book because I quite fancied the idea of the fans and the people getting to know me a little bit better, which seems a bit odd after kind of 40 years, you know, but better late than never, as I say. So, and also to tell a little bit as to exactly how it all happened, you know, and how metal was made, you know, I mean, so a big part of the book is obviously the very early days, me growing up as a kid,
right.
and obviously the rough, getting off to a rough start. I know I'm not alone. There's lots of people like me out there that had a similar kind of thing happen to them. But it was quite miraculous, even to myself. I have to stop and think sometimes.
Yeah.
How did it happen? I had all of this going on, you know, directionless, meaningless my whole life.
Yeah.
But I managed to kind of to shake that off and go forward. And I managed to get onto the world's biggest stages.
Wow.
And I'm thinking I need to tell people how this kind of happened, you know, because it's intriguing for myself.
Mm.
It's, as I said, it's quite miraculous. And also, you know, there's a lot of things to tell, you know, because I know that people are interested. And obviously, it's great to know a little bit more about things.
Right.
And so obviously, traversing through the book, lots of stories, you know, good, bad, and the ugly things, some funny things, some emotional things, you know, because obviously it was a long period of time. So a lot did happen. So I'm thinking, I think the fans will want to know a little bit, as I said before, as how exactly metal was made. And of course, you know, later on in the book, I'll get to the point where obviously my departure from the band and what happened, because I really did feel the need to answer a lot of unanswered questions for the fans and people out there, because obviously in this day and age, now with the internet, I saw a lot of people thinking this, saying this, and I'm thinking, no, that's not right, you know, you're on the wrong track there.
Yeah,
so I'm thinking, let me just put it down into words for everybody to pick up on. So all encompassing, but all very important stuff, I think, for me. You know, I didn't want to, you know, leave the planet at some point and just leave this big void.
Yeah.
You know, it's good to kind of fill in all of the gaps and fill in all the pieces for people. So Heavy Duty, Days and Nights in Judas Priest.
Brilliant. Yeah, well, I very much look forward to reading it. I'm a huge Priest fan, you know, and I personally find it's going to be interesting to hear about the dynamics, because
Priest have always been very professional, and it's quite odd hearing the different dynamics and who got along. And yeah, it's a long time to be with a group of people, so it'd be interesting to know how you kept that working relationship together.
And it wasn't the easiest thing I've ever done, you know, to put everything down, you know, in the book, because I certainly have to state that that whatever has gone by in the past, whatever is happening now, and whatever will happen in the future, I have to say and state that I have total respect for my bandmates.
Yeah.
And because we did an awful lot together, you know, fought a lot of battles, and it wasn't easy, you know, but we got there. In fact, we did even more than just get there. We achieved a lot, and we did live a life together.
Yeah.
We shared a life together.
Yeah.
And, total respect to the guys, because I couldn't have done it without them. It's just basically, I suppose in a kind of chronological fashion, my life and career, in the band, I just kind of went through chapter by chapter and dug deep into the memory banks.
Yeah.
And whatever came out, came out.
Yeah.
I've thought of a lot of things I didn't put in,
yeah.
since. I'm thinking, I would like to have said that. But the thing is, the book would probably be this thick, it's quite a substantial read as it is.
Yeah.
So hopefully there's enough in there to be of interest to everyone, really.
There's been no kind of autobiographies or anything from any of the other members, so it's kind of there's been books out there, hasn't there, written by fans and things, but this is going to be a true statement, really, of what it was like. And, yeah,
it's an inside look, fly on the wall, to a lot of things that we did, and how it happened, And I'm really, really excited, and pleased that the book has been exceptionally well received, globally.
Yeah.
And it's good for me to be able to have the opportunity. Although it seems a bit odd not releasing an album, I'm releasing kind of a book. I'm thinking it's a book. It's a bit different, but there are comparable, similarities. So I'm thinking that, I'm absolutely, I'm relieved now it's done.
Yeah.
It was hard doing it. It was hard kind of doing it. But I'm thinking that, time is not on anyone's side really at the moment, we're all of an age now, myself and the guys in the band. And unfortunately, as metal fans, we hate to see that we're losing, good guys along the way. Trying to look a little bit into the future, we can kind of see that us dinosaurs are collecting on the prairie, ready for migration to the next place we're going to go to. And what will be left, there'll be an extinction at some point to certainly classic metal as we know it, I suppose, simply because we all look to see what's happening new and stuff like that, and it's kind of different. And a lot of people, because I speak to a lot of people, people are still going back to listening to their old vinyls and looking at old footage on YouTube, and a lot of people still discovering what we did in the 60s, 70s and 80s, those three magical decades.
Yeah.
But by the time the 90s came around, I mean, even Priest, we went out there with the great Pantera, and Annihilator. But then, obviously, there was, bands were gaining strength, obviously, the great Metallica, Slayer, Megadeth, lots of great bands. Machine Head, can't leave them out. Lots of heavier bands, heavier than Priest bands, we have to say.
Really, yeah.
Because they were developing more and more so techniques, with detuning, sounding heavier, more aggressive, so metal went to a new place.
Yeah.
And obviously we had, obviously, how many different metals, death metal, thrash metal, name it, industrial metal. Did I ever know what that was? I'm not too sure if I did. But it was incredibly rewarding and fantastic to have been not just a fan and to have witnessed this great, that, you know, the great decades of rock and metal as we know them today, but to also have been a part of it was incredibly rewarding for someone like myself.
Must be very, yeah. On that subject of the like the newer metal out there, are you a fan? Do you think, because I'm a big fan of the kind of older stuff, I love Priest because I think it doesn't age Priest, the music's so fresh whenever you hear it. But I think, personally, I think a lot of the newer bands, they're kind of going away from leather and they're going away from all the things I personally associate with heavy metal. But do you think they're still being kind of inventive, and is it quite a good way to go?
Yeah, I think the industry obviously has changed, and we know it's changed obviously with what's happened, you know. And it's been harmful and damaging in a lot of ways, you know. Even a lot of established bands have had their, you know, kind of pensions taken away from them and stuff like that. So they have to get back out to work and get back on the road and do some gigs, you know, at whatever age, whatever your disabilities might be, you know, and that's a big part of it. Good in some ways, but in respect of new bands, new product and everything, their opportunities have been stripped away, you know, because the support machinery is not there like it used to be from record companies, managements, agents, you know. But we've got more and more musicians with lots of great ideas, but not really been able to fund and put it together and get noticed. So, but there are bands out there, and I always welcome anyone that I meet and speak to send me over kind of links to check out new bands. But I can't help myself, you know, as well. I'm kind of, because Doc and have just got back together after 20 years, so I'm watching footage of those guys, and they're on, you know, there's some great stuff, you know. So it gets to be exciting again when these kind of older bands, well, hang on, we're going to get out, you know, and earn ourselves some money, because we're not getting what we're supposed to do anymore from the, you know, the records that we made. So that's things in a good way, puts people back together. So that's good, but more difficult for the newer bands and artists to come to the surface.
So Ken, personally, I find it really hard whenever anyone asks me my favourite Judas Priest album or song. It's so difficult because one of the things with Priest, which I love, is they're not repetitive. Each album, I feel you're trying to bring something different and experiment, and it never gets kind of stagnant. But if someone was real new to Priest, you know, some teenager who's just getting into metal and they want an album that is going to get them into Priest, what album do you think kind of epitomises what Judas Priest is about?
Yeah, I get asked this quite a lot, and it's so difficult. It is really difficult. But I think if I can just elaborate a little bit, really, on that, I think I've got to go with British Steel.
Really?
Yeah. You know, I've got to do that because I think that that was the album for Judas Priest that consolidated everything,
right.
You know, because it was the first album that, you know, that Judas Priest was completely had the leather studs look, you know, everything on that album was quite complete for Priest, you know. I think just prior to that album, I think there was just myself and Rob that were kind of wearing leather and stuff. And then suddenly it just, you know, thankfully it just came together, that, you know, because I kind of tell a story that, like, when I was growing up, when I was a kid, my two sisters used to drive me mad listening to the transistor radio, listening to the Beatles and Elvis and Cliff Ridges and all of that stuff, you know, and all of that Merseybeat stuff, you know. And I became aware that all of the, a lot of these bands all had a uniform look. Yeah. They all had the same clothes, the same haircut and everything. Yeah. So what did we all do as blues rock musicians? We gave that wide berth, you know. Yeah. So we thought, we go out there, we all have our own separate identities, and that's what we do. And go back through history and look at the bands, Zeppelin, Taste, Free, you know, whoever it is, you know. Yeah. Everybody's got their own, I'm going to wear this tonight, and this guy looks like... Because we didn't want that kind of uniform look. And then as we kind of were evolving as a band, you know, I was always kind of dark, heavy, moody. Could never be heavy enough, you know, heavier the better, whatever it is. But at some point, so we had a great name for the band, Judas Priest, moody, great, you know, songs great. All of that was evolving, you know, but along the way, the clothes kind of stayed the same in a way that they were kind of bright and kind of, you know, eclectic color wise, you know, yellows, pinks, can I say, greens. And sometime in the mid-70s, I'm thinking, it's not right. Surely what we're doing here, the colour for us has to be black.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm thinking it has to be black. So I'm thinking, I'm going black.
Yeah, that's a good
thought. Whatever happened, going black. And by that time, I was wearing some, like, over-the-knee black leather boots and stuff. I did have some white ones made that were really cool.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking, you know, the leather thing, a bit more came into it.
Yeah.
Black, leather. And I don't know what happened, and I'm thinking, but I want people to see me, you know, I'm going to stick some shiny stuff on there, it's got to be metal studs, whatever, you know, and I was always one of those guys. I mean, you know, just elaborating a bit too much, but even in the mid-80s, I was going to the hardware store and buying studs and knocking them into my guitars, you know, more studs, more metal. I was kind of, was always like that. But then it came to me, the fact that what we really need, this band really needs, we do need a uniform look, because it'll make us more powerful.
Yeah.
I'm thinking our image will be more, we go out there and I don't know, it's like an army platoon or whatever. Something that bonds us,
you know,
all together. And I'm thinking that needs to be worked on a bit. And I was absolutely right, because proudly, from the point on, you know, we would be waiting to go on stage wherever we were in the world, and we're there waiting to, and I would look at my bandmates who were there with all this leather and studs. We weren't exactly the same. We all had our own kind of different clothes, but the common denominator was like leather, black, and the studs. And I'm thinking, I could see the lights glittering on us, and it just felt really powerful. And we went out there in a kind of regimented look type of way. And that's what we really did need to have. And of course then, really proudly, it was great that spilled over into the audience. The audiences took, you know, denim, leather, studs, and the metal army was being born, and great, you know, and so, fantastic that it all happened.
Yeah.
So going back to the question, obviously all of that really did come to fruition with British Steel, because we had then great band name, great album. We felt we just made a really good album. Great, didn't really know it at the time, but the album cover, metal, you know.
Yeah.
And that razor blade, there was blood all over that album cover to start with, but we had to curtail it a little bit. And then and we had the look, so everything came together, and we went out there, and I really do think metal was really truly made, was born and made, and was set sail on that British Steel tour.
Brilliant.
So it's got to be that album, I think, really. Everything before was getting to that point. And everything after was a result of that point.
Yeah. So, KK, I was wondering, Is there any like music projects you're kind of thinking about doing at the moment? I know you've put a lot of concentration into this book, so you probably haven't had much of a chance, but is there any projects that have come your way that you're thinking about? Or
all the time, you know, I mean, crazy enough, while I was waiting for you to obviously to set up for the interview today, you know, yeah. I was on the phone to some guys from Poland.
Really?
Wow. Yeah, they want to fly me to Poland in a private jet or something like that, maybe play a couple of songs and play a solo on the album. But, you know, without mentioning any names today, but, you know, anything could happen at any point. But as you say, I'm very, very busy with the book at the moment.
Yeah.
So that's spinning as fast as it possibly can globally, which is like fantastic. Love it. Absolutely. Great. You know, a lot of metal fans in the world. So not too many people have done books, I guess. No, people like me, you know, so from the metal world. So it's pretty unique in that sense. So yeah, it's pretty cool.
Definitely. Brilliant. I wanted to get onto an album. You probably might wonder what one it is. I think it's an absolute masterpiece, one of the most creative albums Judas Priest done, in my opinion. But I'm quite surprised it had quite a mixed response from the fans, you know, quite a lot of hate, but a lot loved it as well. But Nostradamus, are you very kind of proud of that album? Is that one you?
Absolutely, you know, and just to say some words about that, I mean, it's, you know, for a lot of people, you know, fans, and I guess I was the same, you know, a lot of people think that people like me and us, that we're kind of ageless, timeless, it's always, we can always do this and always do that, but, you know, time and our career and everything about us is moving on, you know. I mean, I wish I could say that my body was still regenerating, but it's not, it's degenerating, you know. So we have to do and fulfill our careers as much as we can and get it out of our systems, I think, you know. And we, by the time we come to do that record, we've done an awful lot, you know, achieved a lot, done a lot of things. But as you said before, Matt, Priests were a band that were always and never afraid to change, experiment a little bit, push the boundaries of metal as far as we possibly could, you know. And it sounds crazy now, but kind of 10 years ago or whenever we started that record, you know, I didn't feel like a young person. I felt I was kind of old and established. And I'm thinking maybe it's time that we did something like this, you know. Again, it was different. A challenge, and musically, again, we could bring something different to the table. So a lot of reasons we did that album. Musicians, we tend to think, oh yeah, but yeah, but if it's good, they're gonna like it, you know. It's not specifically true, but we have to get these things out of our systems. But I would invite everyone to revisit Nostradamus, because don't wait until we're, you know, us guys, we're all kind of 6 feet under. We have to say these things. We have to face up to fact. Don't wait until we're not on the planet anymore, you know, and then think, well, you know, and somebody maybe decides to put Nostradamus in theatres, or, you know, takes it out there and tours with it. And, you know, don't wait, and, you know, I don't want to see it be then. Check it out now and talk to us about it and discuss it and bring it out in the open. But I think that as a part of the Priest legacy, the catalogue, for me, it's totally bona fide. We did a lot of things. There's a lot of good guitar solos on there, I think. And there's a lot of great, you know, melodic stuff that we probably would never have seen the light of day. We're fantastic platform to show exactly what Rob can do in, with different dimensions, because let's face it, he could have been an opera singer. He's got the great, vocal cords. Again, it's creating metal for the masses, and and everyone, don't wait until you're in that rocky chair rocking away, you know, at the age of 80 or 90, because you think, oh yeah, Nostradamus, you know, it was a good album after all, it sounds good, you know, and turn up the hearing aid and not too bad, you know. So get stuck in now and give it another shot, and check out Future Mankind, the closing track. It's full on metal, you know, and listen to me doing some improvised shit on the end of that, you know, it's pretty good, wailing away, yeah. So,
it's nice to hear you talk about it, because it's one that I just love. It was kind of a gateway kind of thing for me, because I always, growing up, I loved Priest kind of. I remember hearing Johnny Be Good and Breaking the Law. As soon as I heard those songs, I thought, oh, I want an album. And I got Nostradamus, and from there, I've got like every album now. And it was actually one that really got me into it, so yeah.
Fan challenge that wasn't really into Nostradamus. Next time you go on a car journey, and it's a couple of hours long, and you think, oh God, I gotta do that journey again. Put Nostradamus on, and you'll be there in no time at all. Trust me.
Yeah, that's perfect.
Fan challenge.
Do it, come on. So with your book, Heavy Duty, is it gonna be available in most countries? Is it?
Yeah, so where we're at the to start with, it's been released in kind of North America, Canada, I think those publishers cover South America as well in some kind of way.
Yeah.
Obviously released in the UK. And up to now, as far as I can remember, it's just Finland, Germany, and Bulgaria. I think so. But kind of what happens is a lot of these markets are test markets. And obviously, if the book does well, then hopefully, all being well, other countries will pick the book up quite soon. So I am talking to people in Czech Republic, Poland, Spain, and you know, quite a lot of Norway, quite a lot of other countries. I'm doing interviews, so hopefully that will have a knock-on effect and incite publishers in that country to pick up the book, do a translation, and make it available in those countries.
Excellent. Yeah, and for the UK-based readers, I guess, would what kind of, do you know what shops it'll be available in? Is it Waterstones and that kind of thing?
Yeah, I think so, pretty much. And obviously, it's growing all the time.
Brilliant.
So obviously, just Google it. You know, KK's book. Obviously, it's available on Amazon and that. Yeah.
No, excellent. Right. So right now, where are we? Where are we sat? What is this place?
Yeah, where are we now? Yeah, obviously, we're here. So what's happening? This is a big venue.
Yeah,
it's great. It's a labyrinth. You know, we're in the main stage arena. We just had Skid Row here a couple of weeks ago, which was great. You know, fantastic. So obviously, looking to new. It's a brand new venue. Holds about 4,500 people. Capacity wise, yeah. Cool. So it can be curtailed down to just 1,000 people. So it's very versatile. It's in Wolverhampton, which is not far from, you know, the big labyrinth. There is the Black Country, Birmingham, Dudley, West Bromwich, Walsall, Wensbury, you know, Cannock. It goes on. Massive place. So this is, you know, metal land. So it's great. The place was an old car factory that dates back to the 1800s. Actually, so it's a full-on metal, because the idea was to obviously provide a facility that's not kind of sterile, and you know, and you know, it's a big hangout place. You know, so we can have literally festivals all day and all night, because the guys have got a bar license till I think it's 5 a.m. so it's pretty good. So not too long before the next day's kind of transport kicks in.
That's really good, because so many venues, I'm from Bristol myself, but it's so hard to find anywhere past about midnight. So I don't know what Birmingham's like, but that sounds a pretty good
the whole of the Black Country needs a good full-on metal facility. So that's it, really.
Yeah.
So the steel mill, and watch this space. We'll try and provide lots and lots of more great metal, rock and metal bands here in the future.
Right, so as a musician myself and to other musicians out there, I was wondering, you've been through it, you know, you've been there, you've kind of achieved what you wanted to. When you think back to when you were younger and stuff, is there anything people should kind of avoid or any tips when trying to kind of get successful in the music industry? Any kind of things you learned along the way that are quite important to anyone starting out?
Yeah, well, where do I begin? You just have to go through the processes of elimination to get everything right. And then when you've got everything right, you've got to be very careful that, you know, within the band, you got the guys, you got the music, you got everything. Yeah. Let's assume that you get even a record deal and, you know, an agent and a manager, you know. Then the next steps are really, you've got to really dig in and learn a little bit about the business. Because otherwise everything is kind of, it's just haziness in the distance that you don't know anything about. You know, and obviously lots of people have been burnt, you know. You kind of have to dig in and get to find out details.
And it is a business, I guess, is
it? It's a business. I don't think we never made a penny until we started to learn a bit more about the business, start to ask questions, you know, not just take everything on face value that you were being told. Because, yeah, there's a lot of good guys out there, but there's always going to be, you know, not so good guys, you know, and you're never going to know. So you have to try and get it right. Hopefully now with the internet, you can get on there and do a little bit of research, you know. What is an expected percentage for this merchandise or, you know, or publishing with a publishing deal, you know. Try not to make any mistakes, because it's so sad to see when you've got a good thing going and you've got a good product, we'll have to call it a product, let's say, and you're happy as a band with where you're at, you know, the next level is the business. So you have to really look at that closely.
Well, that's really, really helpful. That's good to know. And I've noticed with a lot of music these days, anything that's kind of on TV, like talent shows, it pretty much doesn't cater to metal. How would you say people who specifically want to get known as metal musicians, how would you say they should go about, you know, getting spotted by the right people? Who are the right people to kind of get noticed by in metal, I guess?
Yeah, I suppose the big thing now, obviously, is the internet, isn't it? You know, it really is. And I do think that if you can work that the internet right, I think that, I mean, I know musicians myself that have been picked up from the internet, and they're on the world's biggest stages now. Not in metal, actually, you know, that's kind of more in the in the pop world, musicians. But, you know, it can give you a good leg up. You can get there. The fans will, you know, will find you if you can post something that's pretty cool.
Well, that's good to know, because I'm kind of personally, I'm always putting my music out online on Instagram and YouTube, and I'm always kind of thinking hopefully that's the way to get somewhere. And like but it's always hard to know whether you're trying to get kind of spotted by someone, or do you think people who are kind of doing social media as a musician, do you think they should be happy with just building their audience rather than trying to get spotted by someone? Would you say that's the way forward, just trying to get as many people kind of following and listening to your stuff?
I think so. I think so. Because is there anybody out there looking these days? I don't seem to see it. I mean, in the old days, you'd always get people from record companies going out to concerts all the time, let's say in London, you know, we would often be playing a pub or a club and people would say, oh, so-and-so is here tonight from, you know, there'd always be kind of prolific people. they can be, you know, I mean, I've played pubs and I've heard Robert Plant is in there, is out there, and I've heard, you know, I've heard that, that somebody from, you know, RCA Records or, you know, Island Records is in the gig tonight. You know, this feedback gets back to you, but I don't see that happening too much anymore.
No, that's what I find. Well, that's good to know,
There's no, don't see people really scouting for bands to pick up new artists.
So you'd say do it independently, would you, probably, just to get it?
I think so. I mean, I could be wrong about that, but, you know, I don't hear, I don't get the feedback that things like that are happening, you know.
That's good to know.
With the writing the book, is it a process you enjoyed doing? Did you, or was it quite quite hard to kind of write a book? So I guess some people are writers and they get a real joy out of writing, but you're a musician, so is it something that kind of appealed to you, writing a book, as much as wanting to get it your thoughts down?
I think so. I mean, I'm terrible really, because I'm thinking, people kept asking me about a book, and I'm thinking, if I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it as good as I can possibly do it. And so I knew it would be quite time consuming, you know, because when I get stuck into, I'm just, that's kind of my personality.
Yeah.
You know, I want everything to be as good as it can be.
That's
and so it was a challenge, really.
Yeah.
But I had a lot of, I mean, obviously Mark Eglinton, who obviously actually did the physical, you know, typing of the thing, put the together, he was excellent, really.
Brilliant.
I heard of him, he'd just done Rex Brown from Pantera, he did his book. So I agreed to do it with Mark, and he made it as, you know, he made it as easy as it possibly could be.
Yeah.
And did push me that little bit extra, few yards to get, to dig into my memory banks, especially, you know, when I was, my childhood and stuff.
Yeah,
it was good.
Yeah.
So overall, is there anything that really stands out to you, like your proudest moment in your career? Are there any shows or any albums or any moment just that's your most proud kind of
metal achievement?
It's hard to say. I'm just like, I've just scanned through all of those years and decades with my mind pretty quick. No, obviously there was a lot of good gigs, a lot of good tours, you know, a lot of good memories. It's been great to meet everyone, really. Obviously not just the fans, obviously a lot of people in a lot of other bands.
Yeah.
It's been good, really. It's big, like a big family type of thing, really. But I think that, yeah, we've done some. I think probably more the charity stuff.
Really? Yeah.
Comes into mind, really, like Live Aid, for example. We were, I think, the fifth band to accept to do that. We did snowball from there, which was great. We headlined the Teenage Cancer Trust at the Royal Albert Hall, which was great. Because I got to see Hendrix play two shows there in the 60s. And to be able to stand on that stage, you know, it was always, and for a good cause as well. So that was great. But, I mean, behind the scenes, you know, people probably don't realise that what people in the music industry do, you know, lots and lots of charity stuff that we do.
Must be a lot of, like, is it kind of quite constant requests coming in? Is that something that is quite hard, choosing what kind of things to go for? Is there so much?
It can be anything from like headlining a big concert like the ones I've just mentioned.
Yeah.
It could be that, or just literally very personal, you know, where someone asks us if we will visit an individual, a loved one, you know, that's very ill. So we've done that as well. There's obviously a very well-known charity called Make-A-Wish Foundation for terminally ill people and youngsters. So they would often bring, you know, people would come to the concerts.
Nice.
you know, in their support vehicles and stuff, and get to meet us and stuff like that. Lots of emotional things, yeah. We did a detour once. We were playing an outdoor gig. I think Slayer were on with us somewhere in America, up north. But we'd had a very touching letter from an individual, from a fan who was very, very ill. So we cut off the freeway and we went, we left early just to go to this hospital where this, person was. And he was gone by the next morning. We had the phone call. So things like that, but I know of so many people in the industry, so many bands, management companies, including our manager as well, that do so much for charity. So a lot of good comes from what we do also.
Yeah. Well, that's really good to hear, because it's something people don't really know.
It's just stuff that we do. We don't, never tell people unless we kind of get, it comes up,
Yeah, that's really nice. So when it comes to the touring, you hear from a lot of different musicians. Some people hate touring, some people really love it. What was your personal experience, and did you enjoy touring?
There was times when it was, there were decades when it was great, towards the end, it got a little bit it got harder towards, the end. It kind of, because things had changed, you know. Loads of fun, really. Yeah. It was great to see the world, wasn't it? Really was, But I said towards the end, we would kind of play the same cities that we've been to many times, I think the last tour I did, I got to go to Colombia, which was great, and Korea, which was great. New territories, exciting.
Yeah. Is that kind of probably the biggest buzz, going somewhere different, like somewhere you've never been?
It did. I mean, to begin with, everywhere was new, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Whether it was Little Rock, Arkansas, or Biloxi, Mississippi, or whether it was New York, everything was new. Yeah. So we were just like, kids in a candy store. It was a big adventure. Seriously, big adventure.
It must be exciting.
It was.
Does it become a bit of a chore as the years go by, or is it still quite fun? Is it the thought of it?
No, it got more of a chore towards the end. We were all obviously older, and lots of people around us were older, and I think, it was still good for the most part. But you spend an awful lot of time away from home.
Yeah,
I think as I got older, I had a desire to want to spend more time in the UK and more time, see my mum more, family more. That's all nice. Of the sacrifices that I'd made, I'm thinking I want to make up a little bit for that as well.
That's understandable. I think a lot of people say, why leave? But you've got to kind of enjoy your life a bit as well. Apart from the kind of band, I guess, you've got stuff you want to do, average everyday thing.
Yeah, because I did. I mean, don't talk too much about the sacrifices in the book. Some of them are fairly obvious, but wantingly, everything was all about the music and doing what we did, write, record, tour.
Yeah.
And it was what was wanted, but as the decades go by, with lots of changes, the industry, it just changes come about.
So I was wondering, with leaving Priest, was there any disagreements kind of artistically? Was there anything you wanted to kind of strive for, but it just wasn't happening, or was it more different reasons overall?
Yeah, no, it wasn't that so much. I mean, I was asked to start writing for an EP, which I wasn't happy about.
Yeah,
no, didn't want to do that.
No.
No. That was, I was just said no, really.
Right.
You know, and so.
Yeah.
Priest is not an EP, not after the epic Nostradamus and,
no, it's got to be, you know.
Fortunately, the guys saw sense and made better of it and did an album, which is the right thing to do, I think.
Is there a, because personally to me, one show that I've watched over and over, I could like repeat it, you know, it's the Live Vengeance 82. To me, that's metal, that's the most metal performance. You know, a lot of people rate Queen as one of the best performers and at different gigs and stuff, but I've watched that performance over and over, and I just think nothing's ever compared to that specific performance. Any good memories of that show or of anything spring to mind?
It was good, it was really good.
Yeah.
You know, it was, we were pretty much in the margins of our peak. Really then. Again, I talk about when bands are out there doing what they do in with kind of a free spirit, without anything affecting them.
No.
You know, because I talk about, like, obviously the great Jimi Hendrix, fortunate enough to see him, you know, in the short window we had with his lifespan. Yeah. I managed to see the front half.
Wow.
You know, I saw him play concerts and he would go out there completely unaffected by the business, you know, drugs or whatever else might have came in, you know, but it's kind of documented now. I've seen some documentaries where Hendrix was troubled before he died. You know, he was involved with people that were kind of pretty heavy, you know, in management. And it kind of affected him later on, seemed to be he was affected, you know, but I saw him play, as I keep saying, as a free spirit. And you see Judas Priest in those days as a complete free spirit.
Yeah,
you can tell that these guys on this stage are doing exactly what they want to do. And they're loving it. You know, whereas later on towards the end of my, you know, participation, you know, you could, you know, it's almost like, you know, we become affected by various things.
Yeah.
Probably affected by the sheer fact that we're out there and we've been doing this for as long as we have.
Yeah.
Whereas on that video there, we hadn't been doing it long enough. Can't get enough of it.
Yeah.
And it shows in the performance, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
You know, it's something I missed. I missed that.
Yeah, must understand what I said. Although there was other reasons for your leaving, do you think partly because you had other thoughts going around in your head, did you think, you know, unless you're feeling that freedom like you did, say, on that 82 show, do you feel like that's a reason for you to step out as well? Because unless you're feeling that...
Exactly, it's exactly that. And I've got to say, we were like that. We felt that we were up and we got further to go, which we did. And then you go over the, you know, you reach a kind of peak and there's kind of, you hate to admit it, you know, but there's some kind of decline where we're looking older, not as fit, not as, you know, I always had a saying, the older we get, the younger we've got to play, you know, but, and that's how I felt about it, but it wasn't really happening.
No, do you think a lot of bands should take on that thing, like these bands who keep going, and I won't name names, but a lot of these metal bands are, it's a new tour, and you kind of hear that they're not really wanting to do it, you know, that it's like this is the last tour, and then something makes them do another last tour. Like, do you think they should just, if they're going to do a last tour, that's it, or do you think flog it out to death or not?
Well, it's like anything else. I mean, we heard that, you know, Sabbath did their, you know, it was the final thing, but Ozzy's going out again with Priest supporting. That's going to be a good ticket.
Yeah.
You know,
that.
That's going to be a good ticket. You know, Never say never, never say die. What can I say? Is that a song title? Because it's hard to think of song titles these days.
Yeah, that's probably
you know, one. We've heard Never Say Never and we've heard Never Say Die, but Never Say Never, Never Say Die combined. I can almost hear it in my head now.
Talking of that, how do you, when writing a new song, do you, when you did write the songs with the band, were you kind of lyrically involved quite a lot, or was it more the riffs and the solos, or?
Yeah,
what
we did quite simply, we'd finish a world tour and somebody would say, okay, you've got to make a new record. Yeah, so sure. In our own time, we would put our own stuff down, myself and Glenn, concentrate on the music, coming up with as many musical ideas as possible. And Rob would go away and draft out lyrics and stuff like that. Yeah, yeah. And at some point we'd go, okay, we've all got a fair bit of stuff, let's get together.
Yeah.
It was myself and Glenn mainly when we felt we'd got enough song ideas put together, we'd pull Rob in, start working on it.
Yeah.
And it was just like praying a wing. It was kind of, there's no real set formula, but it worked for us.
Brilliant.
Kind of makes sense.
Yeah.
Stage one, get as many ideas as you can individually. Because the other guys, if you walk into the room at some point and he's got twice as much as you, you're going to like to get a lot of stuff down and do that, work on that, maybe 4 or 5 songs, something like that.
Okay.
Have another break, go and put more ideas, come back together and keep it as fresh as you can.
Brilliant, yeah, well that's a great advice for any songwriters out there for sure. Yeah.
Don't all sit there in a room and say, okay, we've got to write some songs now. Okay, somebody start playing.
Yeah.
It doesn't work.
Yeah, because
when I'm writing songs, I find it quite, I can't sit down and write a song. I don't know if it's like that with a lot of people, but I'll just think I'll have to go through an experience or something and then I'll be inspired to write, but I find it very hard. So I don't know if it's like that for a lot of people. I've got to kind of go through something to want to write something and have something on my mind. I couldn't just come up with something out of thin air very easily.
It was good for us because we had 2 guitar players, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, 2 guys. It was quite competitive coming up with ideas. I think that's what kept us pretty prolific, you know. And obviously then we were able to bring Rob in.
Yeah.
You know, it was a good formula, really.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, and what do you think made Priest different to all the other kind of metal bands that kind of followed kind of around the same time? What do you think Priest had that maybe the others didn't to make them so unique kind of thing?
Well, yeah, I think that, I mean, depending on what period of time we're talking about.
Yeah.
But obviously we had exactly that. We had a pretty good songwriting team. I mean, we were certainly, we were fortunate to have Rob, you know, obviously with his ability, because vocalists like him, you know, there's not many around, is there? Obviously we've got the incredible Ripper Owens. You know, Ralph Shapers, you know, another great, you know, with big range.
Yeah.
You know, there's lots of other good singers around, but, you know, certainly for Rob and Ripper, really, and they were seriously durable, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, we never blew gigs because the vocalist got a bad throat.
And
these guys are going out 5 or 6 nights a week, and they were tough, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, I've got to say, these guys, you know, even I, they were my heroes.
Yeah,
being able to go out there and do that.
Yeah.
I used to feel for them, thinking we're kind of on 5 in a row now, you know, and I'm looking at Rob or Ripper putting the stage clothes on. I'm thinking these guys are good.
Yeah, and is there a process? I mean, that you saw anything in common with them both? How they maybe preserve their voice in between shows? Do they not talk much? Or
I said the guys did look after themselves.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that they knew that they had to, really.
Yeah.
You know, so it's important to, you know, look after your voice, really. I mean, you start going to the bar with the lads and chugging it down. I mean, you're going to be, you can't do that without talking.
Really.
I mean, it's like, you know, the guys were very good and getting plenty of sleep. And
quite a lot of discipline.
Yeah.
Would you say they missed out maybe partly because I'm guessing you could go out and have a drink after the show and whereas they might have had to stay in and is there like...
We're fortunate we had a couple of guys that were in, you know, pretty solid relationships, so they didn't have the need to, you know, they weren't, there's times I was in solid relationships, but you know, it is what it is. You're out there, you're 1,000 miles away from home and you have to, it's kind of difficult. It was difficult for me a lot of times to go to my hotel room and think, okay, I've got to get to sleep now.
Yeah.
It's already like past midnight,
yeah.
You know, when I know there's other things going on in the hotel.
Yeah.
You know, it's like trying to go to Las Vegas and go to bed. It's 11 o'clock. Yeah. No, but like, have you seen what's happening downstairs?
Yeah. Did it have any impact on when you had to play a show the next day? Like, would you really be feeling, oh, how am I going to do this?
Yeah, it was murder at times because obviously a lot of times you might have an hour's sleep before the bus left or, you know, or the transport to the airplane, you know, but you would catch sleep wherever you could, you know, if on a bench in a park or a airport or a taxi going to the airport, cat naps wherever you could, and if you could, by the time you got to the hotel at the next town or city, you got off the plane or whatever, or the bus, if you got into that bed for like 20 minutes before you had a show to go to the sound check, it was like heaven, you know. But lots of times you get to the gig, you do the sound check, pass out in the dressing room, you know, it was all about that. It was hard, but that's the price you have to pay for staying up and partying.
That's it, rock and roll. Was there a favourite tour? Well, pretty much all of them, pretty fun.
Not really, you know. I've got it was all good.
Yeah.
You know, whether we were supporting Kiss or whether we were headlining with Scorpions and Def Leppard, supporting. You know, it was good, you know. I talk a little bit how well we were treated by a lot of people, you know, and that's good. Kiss treated us well. AC/DC were fantastic to us, you know.
Yeah.
And that kind of makes us, then we go on to headline and, you know, it makes us realise, you know, you have to treat bands well, you know, treat them well when they're on the way up because, you know, it can easily be reversed at some point, but that's not why you do it. It's just the fact that you do it, I mean, as good as you can. I mean, like I say, I don't know if I tell the story in the book. I mean, when we were out there with Pantera and those guys were so funny. We had such a good time. But we couldn't work out quite why they used to form a queue outside of our dressing room every night, you know, and they were queuing up waiting for some beers, really, you know. Can we hand out some beers, you know? It was funny, though. They would unashamedly form this queue. It was kind of funny. It was funny. I think, oh, God, they're out there again. But, you know, they didn't realise, and we certainly didn't realise, but their bus driver was ripping their beers off. I think Rex tells that story in his book anyway. I think that's something like that. But loads and loads of laugh. You know, it was great to have great support bands that were no problem, fun to have on, you know.
Yeah.
And so obviously we would treat those guys as well, you know, push the boat out really.
Yeah, that's good. And then,
because we headline acts push the boat out for us, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, AC/DC, we were traveling around in this little van and they said on the longer journeys, you know, we could ride their bus, their big bus, and, you know, it was great, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'd be there with Angus, we'd be talking guitar strings and all of that, you know. First time I saw gold-plated guitar strings, I think,
or something like that.
I was on the AC/DC tour bus. So this is it, you know, we're hanging out with a DC, you know, and Yeah, Salt of the Earth got it. It's great when it's like that, isn't it? You know.
That's how it should be, definitely. Yeah.
But there's a lot of the other type of guys as well, you know, the big egos and heads in the clouds.
I'm surprised you said Kiss were quite nice, were they?
Yeah. Kiss, you know, I think Kiss respected and liked us for what we did.
That's nice, yeah.
You know, as kind of new kids on the block, you know, the story goes they were in New York, we were playing three nights, was it called the Palladium? Some old theatre.
Yeah.
So we played three nights there. And I think the Kiss guys came down and thought, yeah, we'll have these guys on tour with us, which is nice.
Really cool.
Because, I mean, the Kiss guys, you know, the Kiss, they might wear makeup and do all what they do, and the songs that they do, but they were well into what Priest were doing, musically. You know, I don't know whether they've ever said that, but they would be, because they were kind enough to go, we'll have these guys. These guys are good.
That's brilliant.
You know, and we went out there and... it was good, and those guys were good to us.
Nice. Well, that's nice to hear, yeah.
I wouldn't say we had all the lights and sounds and monitors in the world, but, you know, it was their show, and we respected that.
Yeah.
But they, and it was good. Got to play pool in the hotel with Ace and Peter and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And since, you know, we've become, you know, not, I wouldn't say good friends, but Gene in particular would often come to Priest show when we were in town and hang out a bit. Yeah?
Yeah,
very, very cool guy.
Yeah, well, that's really nice to hear. Yeah, nice to know kind of fellow, you know, metal bands that really got on with you guys. And yeah, it's nice, nice insight there.
Right, we've got some fan questions now, some from some celebrity
names that you might have heard of, some you've probably toured with and things, and some from fans. We've got a mixture from Instagram and some from my Priest fan page on Facebook, Judas Priest UK Serbia, so a real mixture here. So first off, we've got Michael Shaw. He was wondering, ever thought about doing a solo album?
Yes, lots of times, really. Only since leaving Priest, I think. You know, when I was in the band, it was never really appealed to me, to be fair.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, because Rob was doing solo albums, Glenn was doing solo albums, you know. I think that, you know, if everybody goes off at different times to do solo albums, you never get anything done,
exactly,
you know. But.
Yeah.
So no, I think about it, but really I was just dedicated to Priest. You know, if I have some good musical ideas, I'm going to put it
to
Judas Priest.
That's a good effort, definitely. Yeah.
You know, why should I put musical ideas on an album that's good enough for Priest? Why should I put those on a solo album?
Exactly, yeah.
Doesn't make any sense, you know.
Mm.
You know, look after the mothership, you know, the flagship,
yeah.
And the fleet will look after itself. So that was kind of my take on it.
Well, we got one now from Nick Turner. You might know him from his Hawkwind days. He's just wondering, he asked, were you in the band when they supported Hawkwind at Southend Cutsaw?
Don't recall. May have been, but I don't think that was the case. But I was certainly in the band when we supported Hawkwind at the Reading Festival. Whatever year that was, 76,
sure.
Something like that. When Lemmy was in the band, and it was great. There was us. I think the UFO were there,
really?
I believe. Yeah, I seem to remember bumping into Michael Schenker.
Yeah.
And so that was good. Yes, I was there then.
Can't get much cooler than that. Right, we've got one from Liz now. She was wondering, what was your most memorable experience as a fan? So tables are turned here.
I say it's well documented, really. Just all of the concerts I went to, really, you know. I said my favourite one was the Hendrix concert. The first time I saw him at Coventry Theatre, that just blew me away. And just, you know, I was kind of on this course and I suddenly went like that, you know,
really cool,
in a total different course in life.
Right, we got one now from Ryan Roxy from the Alice Cooper band. He was wondering, do you remember the last time you got to see or chat with Alice?
I think I stand corrected, but I think it was probably the Operation Rock and Roll tour, which we'll be back. We did that just after the our worldwide Painkiller tour. Yeah, we jumped onto that. There was us, Alice Cooper, Motorhead, and a couple of younger bands.
Cool, that's really cool. Right, Roy Z now, I think you'll know. He's wondering, it's a Hendrix-related question, as you probably expected here. What does Jimi Hendrix mean to you, and how many times did you see him live?
I think I got to see him about 7 times, something like that. Yeah, 7
really
times.
Cool.
So, which was very cool. But 2 of those times were at the Royal Albert Hall, you know, nice. On consecutive days. So that was super, super cool. And yeah, just like to say a big hello to Roy, obviously a good friend and a great musician.
Yeah.
And producer.
Yeah.
Roy's got it all going on, really, you know. So yeah, that's good. Did a fantastic job with us, for us on Angel of Retribution. So yeah, I think that definitely that the first time at Coventry Theatre was the big one for me.
Right, we got a very serious question now from KK Downing's Diva. Will you please marry me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Where are I?
So, yeah. Right. God. Now one for Matt.
Right now the answer's yes.
Right, the answer's yes, everyone. Right, Matt wants to know, and it's not me, Matt Cam, I think he's called. Favourite movie, TV show, and meal.
Okay, movie. Yeah, I like, I was kind of a big Clint Eastwood fan. I think The Good, Bad and the Ugly, that, you know, and
yeah,
those few dollars more. I like those. I don't know why, but I did, you know, that and Caddyshack, which is the golf relay, but funny,
yeah.
funny movie. Love that. You know, all golfers love that. And yeah, those two. And TV show.
Yeah.
Not too sure about the TV shows, kind of like quiz shows. I like documentaries, travel shows, all of that sort of stuff. Anything educational.
Yeah, that's cool.
You know.
Yeah. Do you like the Attenborough stuff? Not so much.
Yeah, but like I say, more the traveling, places that I've never been. I'm just watching Joanna Lumley's trek across the Silk Road.
Yeah.
That intrigues me to know it, because it was a long road, that was, from here to eternity, really, at a time when it was very dangerous to do, through a lot of different, so I'm intrigued about that.
Yeah.
Things like that, you know.
Cool, yeah.
Right, Taylor wants to know, how did you first discover Priest, or get discovered by them?
Yeah, I think I write about it in the book, actually. I actually saw, you know, the guys playing in a blues band called the Jug Band at my school.
Wow.
A school. And then tragically, the guitar player was just 18. He drove the van into a telephone kiosk and killed himself. So tragic. So the guys didn't reform that band, and Al and the bass player, Brian Bruno, decided to put a band together, and they were going to call it Judas Priest.
Yeah.
And so I auditioned for that band and didn't make it, because they were kind of very blues orientated, and I wasn't a blues guitar player. I was far more off the wall, really. And but they did put Judas Priest together with a guy called Ernie Chataway, who's passed away now a few years ago. never saw Ernie play, but apparently he was a good player. But and I think they were a band for about a year at the most.
Wow.
And then that disbanded.
So you were there right from the start, pretty much. Very early on. Yeah, that's awesome. So Alex Nello wants to know, what's your opinions on the current guitar duo of Priest?
Yeah, good guys, you know, good players, you know. I don't know Richie, I'd never met him. Andy, you know, I really liked his band Hell.
Yeah.
I really liked the band. I thought they were, I don't know what, but to me, I thought the band, you know, I think they were very, very cool and different.
Yeah.
So that was good. And yeah, so I was a fan of that band. And obviously then he stepped into Priest. And obviously I know of Andy, I've been up to his studio. I've worked there with a new band called Hostile that they're from around this neck of the woods. And and yeah, they are, you know, they're tight players, you know, good players, and doing exceptionally well. By all accounts, I haven't seen the band, but obviously with YouTube, you know, I'm well in tune with what's going on.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. Yeah, it's good. Good to know you're still tuning in. Right, Daddy G wants to know, have you ever thought about doing any other genres of metal, like trying a bit of death metal or black metal? Has that ever intrigued you? Not particularly.
No.
No.
No, not really. I think the furthest, I mean, Priest, we were always, as musicians and a band, pushing boundaries left, right and centre.
Yeah.
So the closest we went was obviously with the Ripper. We call them the Ripper years now, obviously,
yeah,
with what we did there.
Yeah,
that was quite... but obviously with a new, young, strong vocalist like Ripper in the band, we had license to do something a bit.
Yeah, I think it worked, definitely, yeah. Super Addy Z wants to know, what stage clothes were your favourite to wear, and do you still have any of them? Or?
No, I've lost the last stage clothes. Oh. I had them made for the British Steel Tour, which we did in 2010, I think it was. And they've disappeared. I don't know where they are.
It's a shame, yeah.
Yeah, they've gone. So don't have anything. I have some old tour jackets. In fact, a couple of them just disappeared with my last girlfriend. Who's, so good ones. She had the British Steel tour jacket.
Really?
And the Screaming for Vengeance one.
Really? Cool. Lucky.
Yeah, so they've gone.
Yeah.
I think I've still got the Turbo one, and I've still got Defenders of, no, I'm not sure which the other one was. I'll have to check.
Yeah.
I think it was Screaming for Vengeance. No, it wasn't. That had the album cover on the back. No, my girlfriend had that. I'll have to check which one the other one was.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. Cool. Well, this last one, it's not a question as such, more of a statement. Scarlet Rose 666 just wanted to say, you're appreciated, missed, and endlessly loved by the fans, which I couldn't agree with more.
Well, I have to say a big thank you to Scarlett and obviously all the fans that think the same.
Yeah, well, it's been an honour talking to you. It's been a real highlight of my life, to be honest.
Thank you very much, Matt. And like I say, it's been great to be on the channel with you, Metal Matt.
Thanks very much.
And thank you for the opportunity to have a chat with all of the fans out there. And thank you all very much. Wherever you are, and thanks for the support over the years. And I would like to say, obviously with Matt's channel, I know it's been up and running for a while, but this is your first actually live interview
first
with someone. So you know, that's an honor for me. And I'd just like to say to everyone, please give Metal Matt the thumbs up and subscribe to his channel, because guys like me, we're always here to help anything new in metal, you know, just like Matt's channel. So get stuck in there. I'm sure he's going to be coming up with loads more stuff coming your way in the near future, so stay tuned.
Thanks very much, KK Downing.